team player, not this one, the one we're supposed to have is not here. So we're putting a guilt trip on all of our young piano players. Get practiced up, amen, and be here. If you got your hymn book, turn to page 333 and stand with us. We're going to sing Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. You've got to stand up in case the neighbor's leaning too much. Step out of the way, amen. God is our refuge. Underneath are the everlasting arms. We've got that to lean on. So let's sing out page 333.
Receive and be attentive to your words this evening, Lord. Lord, we ask that you speak through Pastor to proclaim only your words here in this house, Lord. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. You can be seated. And upon further request, we will be doing How Great Thou Art. So I generally don't lead this song. We've done it at funerals and stuff, but it's a beautiful song. So let's go take a chance and try it. We have a real hard time, then next time Barry will get to lead the song he picked, amen? And while you're turning there, I did have one announcement. This coming Wednesday night, for those of you that are in our Awanas, Sparkles and Cubbies, and the kids program, we are doing a theme night, patriotic, so you can dress up in red, white, and blue, or, you know, if you've got another patriotic idea, you can be creative. And so I wanted to just plug that, because there could be a cash prize for the best dressed in those categories. So your parents have heard it now, so make sure your kids, follow through with that. Let's sing page 10, How Great Thou Art.
I have to bow.
might have mentioned this, but I heard a preacher say that he had quit watching the news, except for about once a week, so he could figure out what chapter of Revelation we were currently in. So he just, check it every now and then. But all jokes aside, I believe Lord's coming back soon. I really believe that. And so we need to be ready, amen? Be prepared. Our last congregational will be page 138 at Calvary. And we'll sing this, and then our youth choir will come and sing I Believe God. Page 138 at Calvary.
Here's a sin, vanity, and pride. Knowing not it was for me, he died.
to be in the Lord's house. I keep reminding those young people to smile. Miss Deb just handed me a note a minute ago and said to tell you young people, the next time you get up to sing, I'm not going to remind you to smile, but I will take note. And those of you that smile, Miss Deb is going to take y'all out to Bronx. Those of you that do not will be purposely left behind. And so there will be no other reminders, but we will be observing. And so Miss Deb's going to hold that cost of that out of Clay's allowance. Since Clay is supposed to be leading that group and teaching them to smile. I want you to stand with me, and while you're doing so, I did want to, I normally don't take time to recognize our visitors because I'm always afraid I'll miss somebody. Dr. Harper is here with us, and Gracie, and did I get that right, Gracie? No, Miss Deb told me it was Grace.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Faith.
That's the one I thought it was, and Deb said, no, it's Grace. Faith and Grace, pretty close. Okay, well, it's a blessing to have Dr. Don with us, and he and his family served here with us a number of years ago, and Brother Don, it is a blessing to have you and your daughter with us this evening. Now, I want you to go to Ephesians chapter number 6. This morning, in our Sunday school class, as it has been happening more and more often, Brother Gerald taught and brought out the emphasis of commitment, what it meant to be committed. And then Pastor Clay got up this morning and read part of my text, which that happens quite often, even though we do not share notes with one another. And so it really changed the course of my message. But it's still going to be on those lines. Now, there are certain things hitting me in the head right now, so just let me mention, numbers of you have asked about sample ballots. There are sample ballots on the glass table out in the vestibule area. If you do not have one, you can grab one. If you were not here last Sunday evening to hear Brother Jameson go over that ballot, and you need some help with that, you can contact Brother Jameson, contact Miss Deborah. I know many of you wrote down the things that Brother Jameson shared with us, and so there will be no excuse for you not knowing what to do when you get to the ballot box in a week. So with that said, go to Ephesians chapter 6 and verse number 10. I want to read one verse, and then we're going to be going to 2 Timothy, and we're going to be staying with the subject of being strong in the Lord, which in many cases is synonymous with being committed to the Lord. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse number 10, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might." Now, I want you to go to 2 Timothy chapter number 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2, and we'll look at beginning with verse number 1. A number of years ago, I preached a series that I called Higher Ground, and I used 2 Timothy chapter 2 and Romans chapter 12 to preach that series, and so some of you will be familiar. The Bible says, and I'm going to read 7 verses to you there in 2 Timothy chapter 2. The Bible says, "Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangle himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier." Verse 5. "And if a man also strive for masteries, yet he is not crowned except he strive lawfully. The husbandman that laboreth must first be partaker of the fruits." Now, verse 7. "Consider what I say." And I like that phrase because it's like Paul is saying to Timothy, now pay attention to what I've just said to you, but now I'm going to add something to it. He says, consider what I say, and the Lord give thee understanding in all things. We've been talking about discernment for the last month on Wednesday evenings in our Bible study. And the Bible tells us here that if we will be a good soldier, if we will be a committed athlete, if you will, if we will be an aggressive or an intentional farmer, and he gives these analogies, that we will gain an understanding that we will not have otherwise. And therefore, we will be able to be called a strong Christian. Now, with that said, I want to give a strange title to the message, and it will help you to remember. Now, I hope that you remember something besides the title, but I'm going to call this message, Don't Be a Turtle Shell Christian. Do not be a turtle shell Christian, and you'll understand that as we get into the message. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful. Lord, we love you and praise you. Thank you for the joy that we have in Jesus. God, it's good to be a Christian, Lord, especially in a chaotic and a very dark world spiritually. But God, this world's not our home. This is just a temporary place for us. And God, we rejoice in that, knowing that you, the master carpenter, have gone ahead and prepared a place for us. And Lord, one day you're going to come and receive us unto yourself, that where you are, there we will be also. God, thank you for the encouragement. We just praise you now in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. You may be seated. Most of us have observed, especially in recent days or months, if you will. As a matter of fact, this morning as Brother Gerald was teaching, and then when Pastor Clay got up and was preaching, they both alluded to the craziness of 2020. And I'm sure we will all have vivid memories of this year as time goes on. Or it may be your desire not to have memories of 2020, and that would be all right as well. But we know that we live in a very dark and chaotic time. It would probably be wise if we would spend a whole lot more time in the Word of God, because it is never changing, rather than spend our time watching all kinds of news that is always changing from day to day. The only thing that doesn't change about our news is that it's generally bad. It just continues to be bad and even worse. But let me bring that, if I can, to a spiritual level. I believe that we live in a time where popular seems to be important, more important than powerful. And I want you to think about that in the context of the Christian life and the church and the home. You see, we have a lot of popular preachers today, but it doesn't seem that we have a great number of powerful preachers today. And I would put that responsibility right behind the pulpit where it belongs. And you might say, why is that? Because there is much more fear of man today than there is the fear of God. After last Sunday morning's message, I had a couple of pastors call me on the phone to give me some counsel. And a number called us, but a couple of them said, you are making yourself a target. And I know exactly what they're talking about. And you might say, what do you mean by that? There are preachers today that are afraid to get behind the pulpit and listen to me. I'm not talking about giving their opinion. I'm talking about opening the Word of God and simply reading and preaching the Word of God, word for word. There's more fear of man than there is the fear of God. We will come under attack when we preach and teach the Word of God. And when we talk about being a strong and a committed child of God, we are often called legalists and such as that. As a matter of fact, that came out in our Wednesday evening study just this last Wednesday evening. When we use the word obedient to the Word of God, it often draws fire, because people have this idea that the grace of God covers everything. And I'll say this, in salvation it does. But the Bible says that we are saved unto good works. The Bible says that we're to put on the whole armor of God, that we may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. The Bible says we're to be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And
so there's much more leaning toward popularity today than there is powerful preaching and teaching the Word of God. There's a lot of very popular churches today, but a lot of weak churches. Now let me tell you about the turtle shell, if I may. The other day I was riding across the ranch, and I got to a place where we'd been doing some bulldozer work, and I noticed as I was riding there by a large brush pile that there was a little turtle about that big around, and he was lodged under a limb that had been pushed over by the dozer. And so as I glanced down at the little turtle, I want you guys to get a whole different picture of your pastor right now. I felt sorry for the little turtle. Now, if that had been Clay, Clay had pulled out his .45 and shot it, but I didn't. I felt sorry for him. And so I got off my horse, and I thought, I'm going to help that little turtle get unstuck from under that limb. Were y'all proud of me saying that? I mean, so I reached down and got a hold of the little turtle, and as I pulled him out, he didn't weigh anything. And I looked in there, and there was nothing in there. There was nothing but the shell. Now, it looked like a fully alive turtle. Have y'all seen those? They look fully alive, and it looked like that everything should have been fine. I could have just pulled him loose, turned him loose, and he would have taken off. But I looked in there, and there's nothing in there. I looked from his head to his tail. There was nothing in there. Everything had been dissolved, if you will. He had gone away. Now, on the shell, he looked normal. And let me just say this to you. There's a lot of Christians that are like that turtle shell. They look fine. They have an appearance of godliness. But yet there's nothing in there. There's no strength. There's no power. There's nothing there. There are church buildings that look great on the outside, but there's no power on the inside. And so, thus the title to the message, don't be a turtle shell Christian. Make sure that there's something alive in there, and that is the power of the Holy Spirit of God that indwells every true believer. We need to be strong in the Lord and in the power of His life. In many churches today, we talk about spirituality, but there's not much spiritual power. We talk about conviction, but there's not a lot of true biblical conviction in many churches today. We have weak leadership, and once again, I put that behind the pulpit. We have preachers and teachers and fathers that have produced a couple of generations of lightweight Christians, those that cannot stand the winds as they blow our way. It's like the house that was built on the sand and the house that was built on the rocks, and the wind came and blew against the house and it knocked it down because it was built on the sand. It was like a turtle shell that appeared just fine, but there was no life in it. The Bible says that we are to be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might, not tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. Now, the rest of the message is going to be kind of a Bible study. So I want you to get your Bible ready and go to Ephesians chapter 4 and verse number 14 with me. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse number 14. And we're going to be turning to several places, so stay with me, if you will. The Bible talks about being blown around by every wind of doctrine. I used the word lightweight Christians a while ago, and I mean that in a very spiritual way. I mean, there's no depth. There's no weight. In other words, any kind of doctrine that comes along, we just, whatever the last thing we read, we're carried away with that rather than staying with the old path, as Jeremiah called it, the Word of God, or the landmark that we see in the Word of God. And so Ephesians chapter 4 and verse number 14, the Bible says that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and the cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. We live in a time where Christians are being blown around by everything that comes along. There's no stability. There is no strength. I am amazed. And the longer I'm in the ministry, I guess the more amazed I become at those who sit in church services and yet they have no spiritual depth. It's like Pastor Clay said this morning in illustration when he said the young man came up to him and said, "I really enjoyed the message that you preached yesterday." And Clay looked at him and said, "What was the message?" he did not know. He could not tell. He did not remember what the message was. Now, maybe he was just patting Clay on the back so he could maybe have some accolades from Clay. But the point is, there's no depth where there is no receiving of the Word of God. Now, the Bible says we're to be strong, and the only way we can be strong is to immerse ourselves in the Word of God. Now, go to Hebrews 13 and verse number 9. The Bible just said, be not blown around by every wind of doctrine. Now look at Hebrews chapter 13 and verse number 9. The Bible says basically the same thing. He says, be not carried about with divers and strange doctrines, for it is a good thing that the heart be established with grace, not with meats which have not profited them that have been occupied therein. Now listen, he says, in the grace, and that's so important. As Pastor Clay mentioned this morning, if we think that we can do it ourselves, we're going to fall. It's the grace of God. You've heard me quote this verse many, many times. Titus chapter 2, verse 11 and 12. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, that we should live righteously, godly, and soberly in this present world. And so God gives us grace, we are saved. God gives us grace that we may do good works, that we may be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Now, I want you to look at Hebrews 6:1, and let me show you what I believe part of the problem is here. Hebrews chapter 6 and verse number 1. The Bible gives a progression here. It's kind of like the milk of the Word and then the meat of the Word. Baby Christian, and then maybe a young Christian, and then a mature Christian. And we see a similar thing here in Hebrews 6, verse number 1. The Bible says, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ. Now, that's talking about the very basic things, okay? That means that the things that I knew that enabled me to become a child of God, realizing that I'm a sinner, realizing that I need a Savior, realizing that Christ died on the cross for me. Those are the very basics of salvation. But then the Bible says this, let us go on unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works unto faith toward God. What we are seeing here is that there are those that are saved. They feast on the milk of the Word, but it's like they never make the transition from the milk of the Word to the meat of the Word, and therefore we are almost paralyzed at a particular place in our Christian life, not growing, not becoming stronger. Guys, in any other area of life, if that happened, we would see it as very abnormal. Miss Deb and I were sitting there just a moment ago, and some of our grandkids got up to see. I'm looking, Allie is just growing. I'm telling you what, she is like a ragweed that somebody fertilized, I'm telling you. And I mean, she's just growing. It's amazing. But would we not think it strange if your child went from age 3 to age 8 and never grew at all? You would immediately know something was wrong. As a matter of fact, you wouldn't wait 5 years to figure out what was wrong. You'd be taking them to a physician to find out why they were not growing. But yet, in the spiritual realm, people will get saved and they're on fire for the Lord, and they're absorbing the basic oracles of God. They're getting the milk of the Word. But then something happens. It's not always the same thing. I put a lot of responsibilities with teachers that do not prepare and preachers that do not study the Word of God and present the Word of God. But then there's that place that it seems like everything just levels off. And there's no more growing and there's no more strength. The Bible says that we're to grow. It is a command that we grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So where are the strong Christians? Where are those that are anchored in Christ? Where are the strong churches, those that are anchored in the Lord Jesus Christ? Now I want you to once again look with me there in the text in 2 Timothy. So if you'll flip back over there, the Bible says, thou therefore, my son, be strong. Now, how many of you could believe with me that is a command? Being strong in the Lord is a command. As a matter of fact, we see it in numerous places in Scripture that we are to be strong. Now, I told you this was going to be a little bit of a Bible study. Go to Joshua chapter 6. When we look, I'm sorry, Joshua chapter 1. When we go to Joshua chapter 1, we almost always drop down to verse number 8. Meditating on the Word of God. And that's wonderful. But go to Joshua with me and look at verse number, chapter number 1 and verse number 6 and 7. The Bible says this. Now remember, being strong is a command. Being strong in the Lord is a command. It is not a suggestion. It is not taking or leaving. It is a command. The Bible says, and this was the Lord speaking to Joshua, he says, be strong and of a good courage. For unto this people shalt thou divide for an inheritance the land which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Look at verse number 7. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded thee. Turn not to the right hand nor to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. Twice there the Bible says, be strong. All the way down in verse number 9. Have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of a good courage. It is a command for those of us who are saved to be strong in the Lord, in the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, go to 1 Corinthians chapter 16. I'm going to give you several places here so that in your quiet time this week, you will have a Bible study. 1 Corinthians chapter number 16. And the Bible there says in verse number 13, you know, I like this. He says in chapter 16 and verse 13 of 1 Corinthians, watch ye, stand fast in the faith, quit you like men, be strong. Now, I've just given you five or six places where the Bible commands those of us who are saved to be strong in the Lord. Now, I'm just laying some foundation, so stay with me here. Spiritual strength is a command. Paul not only states the necessity of being a strong Christian, but in the text in 2 Timothy chapter 2, he gives us some specific elements, if you want to use that term, to becoming a strong Christian. And that's what I want us to look at this evening. So if you will go back to the text, 2 Timothy chapter number 2, and let me give you some things. Most of you are familiar with this, at least I pray that you are. One of the first things that he uses as an example is the, I guess you could say, the metaphor of a teacher. Now, I like that because it speaks to my heart in as much as before the Lord called me to preach, I was blessed to be able to be a teacher, a Sunday school teacher at the church where Miss Deb and I served. And I always enjoyed that, being able to open the Word of God and teach the Word of God. There's just something about that I don't know, it just encourages one from time to time. How many of you guys have really enjoyed our Sunday school being out in the sanctuary for the last few months? Because we've got to hear numbers of our men get up and proclaim the Word of God, teach the Word of God. It's been a great blessing to me. That's the kind of thing that strengthens us and helps us to become strong in the Lord. So he uses the example, if you will, of a teacher. And I want to just read this to you. He says, now therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men, or teach them to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. Now, so he uses the idea there, or the example of a teacher. Now, I know that people have different ideas about how to get things done, but it seems to me that whether we are talking about something academically or whether we're talking about something practical, we have various kinds of education in our system. You can send your kids to public school and they'll learn all kinds of things about academics. They'll also learn a lot of things that they don't need to know. And then we have trade schools where they can learn other things. But it seems to me that the emphasis is always so somebody can be taught so that they can someday teach another, so they can teach another. That's how trades go on from one generation to the other. That's how we learn. And so Paul uses that talking to Timothy. Now let me just say something about this issue of being a teacher. Producing spiritually strong Christians is like, I claim nothing is original. You know, I don't claim anything is original. I read something where somebody said it was like a relay. Now, how many of you went to maybe school and they had track meets and they ran relays? Y'all know what I'm talking about? You know what I'm talking about? Hold up your hands so I know you're with me, okay? Now, I got to do a few of those, and they were always very interesting to me because we had some of the fastest guys around, but they were the most fumble-fingered guys I ever knew. They couldn't pass a baton one to the other without dropping the thing. And I even came up with this thought one time. If we each one of us could just carry a spare baton in our pocket. And then if they didn't get it passed off, we could just pull it out of our pocket and go on. But that wouldn't work. That would be violating the rules. And that's what we're talking at the end of this text. That's what we're talking about, is going by the rules. Now, I will say something, this as well, that to have a replacement baton would not work because it would not be the original. Now, let me say this. In that context, there's been a lot of Christians running the relay, and they're running well, and they're running fast. But along the way, they dropped the baton, and so they picked up just about anything tossed around by every wind of doctrine. They picked up things that look like but are not the real thing, and they're passing on a substitute for the real thing. And by the time you get to the end of the race, instead of being strong, you're weaker than when you began, because we have laid aside the original. And I'll go back to the Word of God. Jeremiah said, you better go back to the old path.
Right.
Jeremiah said, you better pay attention to the things that you have learned way back then and stay with that which we know is workable. Now, the Bible goes on and shares some other things with us. So it's like a relay. Paul would hand off the baton to Timothy. And when I say the baton, I mean he would hand off the Word of God to Timothy. And then it was Timothy's responsibility to find men that he could, listen, that he could entrust to pass it on to, who would then pass it on to others, and you all get the idea of the spiritual relay. And then, as that went on and on, faithful men passing it on and on and on, I praise the Lord. I just got this. I thank Lord for our church. And I looked around this morning, and even with the COVID thing going on, most of our people were back this morning, and I'm sure grateful for that. But as I think about that and the men that have been teaching over the last 3 or 4 months here in the sanctuary, do you know that it blesses my heart that I know if something happened to me, that I have entrusted the Word of God to other men, primarily in the context of the church, to Pastor Clay. But yet Pastor Clay and I also pass that on to other men who are able to teach. I was telling one of my pastor friends the other day, he said their church hadn't had a pastor in 3 years. Hadn't had a pastor in 3 years. And I said, is there not anybody in your church that could get up behind the pulpit and open the Bible and proclaim the Word of God? God forbid. Are y'all with me? Say amen. I mean, God forbid. And I praise the Lord that there are men in this church who have willingly got in the race, who have willingly decided to be strong in the Lord. And you've taken that baton, you've taken that Word of God, and you're passing it on. The other day I was just kind of in awe. I remember a number of years ago, and they're out this evening. They have some illness in their family, but I was thinking about Brother Pat Skaggs, and Pat moved our community, and praise the Lord, we were able to lead him to the Lord. His family all got saved, and he's been one of our Sunday school teachers for a long time. A couple of weeks ago, it was his turn to teach here, and he said, Pastor Levi, that's the little boy, he must be 10 or 11 years old, said, you know, Levi really wants to preach. And he said, he's got a message ready. He said, do you mind that Sunday morning that I'm teaching if I let little Levi take 5 minutes and share his message? I said, well, I know it. Bless my heart. And boy, little Levi got up behind the pulpit. I wish we had that recorded. You could only see him over the pulpit. And he said, open your Bibles. And man, I wanted to stand up and shout when he said, open your Bible. And he began to read the Word of God and explain the Word of God. And you say, well, how much can an 11-year-old know? As much as mom and daddy teach him. That's how much he will know. And so he just opened that Word of God. And I looked at my watch. He said 5 minutes. But he done gone on 10 minutes. He was getting fired up. And I thought, he's going to take up all of our Sunday school time up there preaching, little 11-year-old boy. You know how that blesses the heart of a pastor when a father takes that word and he says, I'm going to pass that on. And in the next generation, there'll be somebody to receive that. That's what the Bible is talking about when he says, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. It doesn't mean that we are to be reservoirs. It means we are to be distribution centers where we will receive the word and put that word out so that others can share the Word of God. That's what it means to be strong in the Lord. And then Paul uses not only a teacher, but he uses the soldier. I don't know about you, but when I see a man in uniform today, I pray that when you see a person in uniform today, that one of the first things you do is that you want to honor that person. And I see a person of strength. I've seen young men from our community go off to the military. And I can almost describe it physically, but I will not. And they'll go off to the military, and then they'll come back after boot camp in maybe 6 or 8 months of being in the military, and they're hardly recognizable. I mean, they've learned to sit down. They shouldn't have to go to the military to learn that, dads. You ought to teach them that. But, boy, they'll stand up straight, and they'll look you in the eye. And they're dressed right. Are y'all following me along? And so when Paul uses that example of a soldier, there's a reason for that. Now, let me carry you through that, if I may. The scripture says, speaking of the soldier, that there are things that describe a soldier. And I'll just use this, a soldier of Christ who is striving to become strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. First of all, if you'll look there at verse number 3, the Bible says, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Do you know that when I think about somebody enlisting in the military, I think about them being willing to suffer hardship. Now, I've never been in the military, but I've heard a lot about boot camp. And I know that boot camp now is totally different than it was 30, 40, 50 years ago. It's drastically different, I can assure you. But when I think about that, I think about a person who literally surrenders his will to a life of hardship. Now, many Christians bail out at that point. Lord, I want to be a Christian. I want to be saved. I want to know, God, that when I die, that I can enter into the gates of heaven. God, I want to inhabit that home that you've gone and prepared for me. But what do you mean about suffering hardship? Now, I didn't sign up for that. Preacher didn't say anything about hardships when he gave the invitation that Sunday morning. Folks, listen. To not preach the whole counsel of the Word of God, I believe is sin. I believe it's sin not to preach the whole counsel of the Word of God. And you hear Pastor Clay and I and our Bible teachers say this over and over and over. Salvation is by grace alone, and we know that. But, I allude to something that Pastor Clay said in a message. When you get saved, you didn't sign up to go to the playground. You signed up to go to the battlefield. And we are soldiers of Christ. And the Bible says that in order for us to be that strong soldier, we have to be willing to suffer hardship. That's what verse number 3 says. Now, he says, no man that warreth. There's another there reference to a soldier. Entangle himself with the affairs of this life. Now, you might say, what does that mean? I think about when a man joins the military and becomes a soldier, that he is, and I'll use the term boot camp again, basic training. It's almost like that he signs up for a period of separation, separated from his family, separated from everything that's been normal in his life, separated from those things so that he might become that soldier. And again, putting it on a literal level, a soldier of the United States Army or such as that. But in the spiritual sense, to be a soldier of the cross of Christ, we need to lay aside the things that could entangle us and be separated from this world if we're going to be strong Christians. A strong soldier also strives to please his master. Now think about master as being authority or the commander in chief. If you're a child of God and you're signed up in the army of God, our commander in chief is the Lord Jesus Christ, and we should strive to please him as it is given to us there in verse number 4. Now, we also know that Paul uses the example, the metaphor of an athlete. When I think about athletes, especially in recent years, I think about you guys in our church that have become avid runners. And you just run all the time. I see you running early in the morning. It's amazing. On Thursday mornings, Pastor Clay and Justin and half a dozen of the guys meet somewhere. They do it winter and summer, and they'll run. Now, when I think about running, I think about on a rainy day, running from my pickup to the house. That's my idea of running. But no, not them. Wind, rain, cold, or heat, they get together and they run. Clay came in the other day and early one morning, I said, "What are you doing?" He said, "We just ran 11 miles. And he just kind of took another breath and went on his way. If I run 11 miles, Life Flight would have to carry me out. Matter of fact, they'd have to pick me up at the end of the first half mile and carry me out. But when Paul talks about to Timothy about being an athlete, if you will, he's talking about a person who is willing to train, a person who's willing to apply, if you will, self-control and discipline. I never thought much about running until a number of years ago. I think it's been 4 or 5 years ago now. I don't remember that some of the young people challenged me to run a 5K. And it was enough years ago that I took the challenge. If that came today, I would not accept the challenge nor enter into the conversation. But they challenged me to run a 5K. And Clay said, "Dad, don't worry, you can do it." He said, I'll help you. I'll tell you how to train. And so we got that thing you run on, you know. A what?
Treadmill.
A treadmill. You know, that thing that you hang your clothes on after you're through with it. And it hangs there and sits there for 3 or 4 years before you take it out to the garage. So Clay told me how to train. Boy, I mean, I trained for about 6 months. And I kind of kept it under wraps. I didn't want the kids to know that I was training. And I got to where I could run a 5K. And I was so proud of myself. I remember the first race we went to, I had so much fun. I smoked those young people like a White House cigar. I'm telling you what, I outran them. But what really got me was, we were on the last stretch coming down the hill at Honor Heights, and a guy about 75 years old, dressed up in a Santa Claus suit, passed me. I mean, he was fully dressed like Santa Claus and passed me. I was so embarrassed. I'd rather been outrun by that turtle shell than Santa Claus, 75 years old. Now, I'm just saying that Paul uses that example of an athlete to tell us that if we're going to be strong in the Lord, because that's how he starts the chapter, "Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus." So as an athlete, I think about those that train. I want you to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 9 with me. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. Let me show you there, beginning with verse number 24. Once again, some of you will be familiar with this. At least I hope that you are. 1 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse number 24 and following there. The Bible says, "Know ye not that they which run in a race run all? but one receiveth the prize, so run that you may obtain. You know why these guys run? Now, you might say, well, it's to get in good shape. Well, that's one reason they run. They want to be in good shape. But the bottom line is they are all practicing, they're disciplining themselves, because there's going to be a race coming up, and there's going to be a prize at the end of the race. I never thought I would see it, but I feel like Clay will come in from a run, and he looks like a first grader that's been to a track meet of first graders. He's got these ribbons hanging around his neck, a little, yeah, that deal that hangs on the bottom of the ribbon. And so his office is packed full of those things. Now, I don't know what they really mean, but they mean something to him because it proves that he was disciplined and he trained and that he ran the race and he finished the race according to the rules and he got the reward. Now, guys, listen. There's something about this race. It's something about being strong in the Lord that we must not lose sight of. It's not just so that we may become strong in the Lord. It's because we are promised a reward at the end of the race. There will be a prize at the end of the race. One day, if we, by God's grace, if we are strong in the Lord, and if we endure to the end, as the Scripture says, one day we will hear Him say, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. I know thy works. Enter into the joy of the Lord." It's more than me just being strong for strong's sake. There is something at the end that should motivate us to be strong in the Lord. And so he uses the metaphor there of an athlete. Now listen, there are many, many things. When I think about discipline, I'm going to back up to the military, if I may, for a moment. I do a lot of funerals. And I love to do funerals where the deceased served our country and the military comes in and does, they call it the military guard, I believe, and they come in and they do the little military honors at the end of the service. And that never, never ceases to move me. And those men, as they salute the casket of the deceased with the flag hanging over it. And then they take that flag and they fold it very meticulously and with purpose. And they present that to some of the survivors. And I can't count the times that I've been in a cemetery. Guys, there's nothing colder than at a cemetery. And there's nothing hotter than a cemetery in the summertime. And I've watched these young people that they send out to do the honor guard. Matter of fact, one comes to my mind especially when, I can't remember now whether it was Mr. Goodmiller or Mrs. Goodmiller that passed, and they buried them out at number 9 at the Bower Cemetery. And it's cold. It's up on the side of a hill. It's cold. And that day it was sleeting, and the wind was blowing about 30 miles an hour, and it was absolutely miserable. And these young people that were in the military, and you might say, yeah, but they're not really soldiers. I mean, they just do that. Listen, I want to tell you, if they're stout enough to do what they did that day, they are soldiers and they are strong. And I watched them. And as they faced that north wind with the sleet coming down, they literally stood there. They hardly blinked an eye. And they stood there. That was the only time I was really motivated to hurry up on a message, because I felt sorry for those guys standing there at attention, but they never moved a muscle. You know why? Because they had trained. You know why? Because they had purpose. You know why? Because that was what they signed up for. And they were diligent to be what they had signed up for. Pastor Clay said this, I'll repeat it again. You didn't sign up for the playground. We signed up for the battlefield. And the Bible says that we're to be strong in the power of His might. We're to be strong in the Lord. Now, I'm going to get to the end of this, so just stay with me. So we understand that strong is not something that just happens. Now, I'm going to go back to Paul's instruction to Timothy. He uses the example of a farmer. Look at verse number 6. The husbandman that laboreth must be first partaker of the fruits. The husband, he's talking about a farmer. Now, there's a lot of things I don't know anything about. I don't know a whole lot about farming. I guess by definition, we would be more ranchers than farmers. But I know a little bit about farming. And I can understand maybe a little bit of what Paul is saying here to Timothy, that is required to be that strong person. Did you know that the farmer labors, or toils, if you will, from early morning till late in the evening? I don't know very many farmers that start at 8 and shut down at 5. It just is not characteristic of a farmer. They start before daylight and they work until dark drives them in. And now that we have lights on everything, you can imagine you can farm all night if you want to do that. The point is that a farmer is a person who diligently works and toils in the heat and in the rain and in the drought and in the floods. He just keeps doing what he does because he is a farmer, and that's what God has allowed him or called him to be. When I think about that, we have young people, primarily young men, that come to the ranch. We had a young man with us a couple of weeks ago from Kansas City, and I would emphasize city. And if he's watching tonight, I'm going to use you. Do I have your permission? Thank you. So I don't know what he expected when he and Pastor Clay worked out the detail of him coming to help us for a week. But he told Pastor Clay, he said, I want to work. He said, I've been on a dude ranch, where the kids came their own horses off. But he said, I want some experience being on a ranch. So Clay worked out all the details, and the young man showed up, and I was quite excited because we had a lot to do that week, and he was a really stout, fit young man. I thought, man, praise the Lord, sacrifice. Sacrificing his body, I'll tell you. So that Sunday night after church, he and Miss Deb were conversing, and I said, guys, listen, it's time to go to bed. I said, we've got to get up in the morning, and we got work to do. He goes, what time are we going to get up? I said, I'm going to be real nice to you. I'm going to let you sleep till 5. I said, we have to have a load of cattle loaded and out on the highway by daylight. And he kind of looked at me like, you mean 5 a.m.? And I said, don't worry, I'll wake you up. And so the next morning, I didn't have to wake him up. Man, he was excited. First day at the ranch. He woke up, and by the time we finished that evening, it was about 9:30. We got in, Miss Deb fed us a little bite. I thought I was going to keep him awake while he ate his food. He was going to go to bed fasting that night. I wouldn't let him. I said, you got to have something to eat. I said, now in the morning, Clay's going to pick you up at about 5:45. He said, no problem, I'll be up. He was not up. He was embarrassed because I had to wake him up. But I was nice to him. I said, this morning is a courtesy call. Tomorrow, in the morning, it will be a glass of cold water in your face. So after that, he got up. Now, the point I'm making is all week, we did what we do. We built fence. We cleared fence rows. We gathered cattle. We got dirty. We just do what we do. At the end of the week, I said, I got up and left and came to the church on Saturday morning. I said, when you get up around, come to the church before you head back to Kansas City. He came by and I said, so what do you think? He goes, about what? I said, what do you think about the ranch life? And he goes, well, it's not really. He said, y'all don't have a dude ranch. And I said, I know we don't have a dude ranch. And the point I'm making is this. Sometimes we have a misconception about the soldier, about the athlete, about the farmer. We have misconceptions about what that's all about. I remember years ago, and I know Clay will remember this, we had a young man that came to our church for a while, his family did, later they moved away, he would come out to the ranch occasionally and spend some time with Clay and I, and I remember one day he made this statement. Now, some of y'all are going to think this is absolutely nuts, and you're right, but it also lends to the idea that there's a misconception about what it means to be a soldier of the cross. What it means to be a biblical husbandman. What it means to be a biblical a biblical athlete as Paul describes these things here. This young man said, I've got it all figured out. When a young man about 18 years old tells you he's got it all figured out, listen up. Because it's going to get good. He said, here's what I'm going to do. He said, I'm going to get me, now, I know some of y'all are grinning already. He said, I'm going to get me about 2,000 acres, a whole bunch of cows, and I'm just going to sit back and watch the money roll in. Now, you know what y'all think right now? That kid must have been a nut. Yeah, I think that would describe him well. Because he didn't consider anything except what he might be getting out of it. He didn't understand what it took to get there. He didn't understand the hours and the time and the planning. He didn't understand any of that. He just wanted what was at the end. There's nothing wrong with a child of God desiring what is at the end. We should desire what's at the end, but not to the neglect of what it takes to be a strong soldier of Jesus Christ. Being strong is not a suggestion. I said I was going to get to close with this. Let me do that. Did you know that being strong, and I praise the Lord so many times, I praise the Lord, that God put people around me to be good examples for me. But those of you men that are here tonight, I want to say this to you men, especially you fathers. I will always strive to be the best example for your children that I can possibly be. Our teachers, Pastor Clay, we will strive to be the best we can be, the best examples we can be for your children. But dads, I want to tell you, it is your responsibility to get in that relay race and pass on to your children the things that are necessary to help them finish the race and receive the reward that is at the end of the race. We must learn to persevere. And let me close with 1 Corinthians 15. Go back there with me. 1 Corinthians 15 and verse number 58. Let me read that to you. If Ms. Kristen will make your way to the piano, please. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse number 58, I believe. 1 Corinthians 15 and verse number 58. Yes. The Bible says, therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast. I like that. Steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Why should we be strong in the Lord? First of all, it's a command. And second of all, at the end, there is a reward. Our labor will not be in vain. We need to be strong and not weak. We need to be excellent and not average as soldiers of the cross. And I want to encourage you to be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Let's all stand together. You just stand with me with your heads bowed and your eyes closed. This Christian's going to play. My question tonight is simply,